You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans, America's largest mortgage lender. Spring will be here soon, so if buying a new home is on your to-do list, right now is the time to call Quicken Loans. Learn about which mortgage options make sense for you and get a jump on your competition. With our exclusive Rate Shield approval, the low rate you lock today is protected for up to 90 days while you shop for your new home. With a Rate Shield approval, if rates go up, your low rate stays locked. But if rates go down, you get that new, even lower rate. Either way, you win. Talk to us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com to take advantage. Here's another great reason to work with us. For a record 9 years in a row, J.D. Power has ranked Quicken Loans highest in the nation in customer satisfaction for primary mortgage origination. Again, to lock in today's low mortgage interest rate and get the security of our exclusive Rate Shield approval, call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com.
For J.D. Power award information, visit jdpower.com. Rate Shield approval only valid on certain 30-year fixed-rate loans. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. License in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.
Hi, welcome to the Subway ad for the new Sesame Ginger Glazed Chicken Signature Wrap. How would you like it?
I'll take a...
Sports announcer at home?
Yeah, how'd you...
We just know.
My wife picks up the new Signature Wrap. It's got double the rotisserie-style chicken mixed with a sesame ginger glaze. She appears annoyed at me, but she shrugs it off. Those sweet and savory flavors are calling her name. She lifts the wrap and... She takes the bite! Incredible! And now she's closing the door on my... Subway, make it what you want.
Limited time only at participating restaurants. Double meat basement, average 6-inch sub.
I'm Little Teapot, short and stout.
Here is my handle and here is my spout.
No, Dad, like this. When I get all steamed up, then I shout, tip me over and
pour me out.
This is WWE superstar Roman Reigns. It only takes a moment to make a moment. Take time to be a dad today.
Visit fatherhood.gov, brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
It's time now for the Conservative Curmudgeon Radio Show. Now, here's Grouchy.
Good evening. Welcome back. Good to be with you again. We got a lot of stuff to talk about tonight. Before we get rolling, programming reminder right after me, which of course you want to be here for. That's why you are here. Right after me tonight, FUBAR with PolitiBunny and Ordy Packard, followed by Dan and Rick with Robinson and Wright, and then America Off the Rails with Rick for your nightcap a little later on. But here we go. And there were people today talking about Chat Lives Matter. I saw you today, and I have the chat open, and I am here to say that I am not impressed yet. So... Varick, I'm sorry you're locked out of Twitter. I don't know what you did, you goofy little bastard, but glad you're in the chat room. Anyway, all right, so let's see. What do we got tonight? Well, I'll tell you what we got tonight. We got the sounds that you're hearing, those little off-in-the-distant explosions, the little popping sounds. Those are all the liberals' heads exploding tonight over Alabama's Governor Kay Ivey signing Alabama's abortion bill into law, the strictest in the nation. Now, before anybody gets going too crazy, just know right out of the gate, this will probably hit the courts tomorrow. They've been sitting waiting to challenge this, I'm sure. So there will be an injunction. It will be appealed, and then it will be appealed again. Look, the whole idea, if you just follow the news of this bill from its inception, the sponsors of the bill are women, primarily. There are some men that contributed, but women spearheaded this movement. So I guess it only makes sense that a woman governor signs it into law, and then everybody on the left dubs them misogynists, right? I mean, really, that just makes all the sense in the world, doesn't it? Those misogynistic women. Yeah. How dare a woman support the right to life of a baby? I saw idiots spewing things over the last several days that ranged from when a woman gets pregnant, it's not a human being that's inside her. That was a classic idiotic statement. How do you even if you believe that it's not a fully formed human, even if you are ardent in your belief that it is a fetus or a zygote or what, you're describing stages of development of a human. Yes, those terms are applied to non-human species as well. That doesn't make the human any less human. Look, the passage of this bill by Alabama's legislature, and it is the nation's strictest abortion law now. It's not a bill anymore. It is law as of about an hour ago. Well, hour and a half ago, you're seeing a huge ramp up across the South and Midwest. States are making their move on the highly emotional and controversial topic of abortion. These laws not only limit, if not eliminate, options for abortion in individual states, they essentially are inviting a more conservative U.S. Supreme Court to weigh in, and their hope is to reverse the 1973 Roe v. Wade decision. Now, some states have long been active in their anti-abortion efforts. Many now find the political atmosphere under the Trump administration more supportive, particularly after the addition of two conservative justices on the high court. It's clearer than ever that Roe is far from settled law in the eyes and hearts of the American people. And this is increasingly reflected in state legislatures. Marjorie Danzfelser, president of the Susan B. Anthony List, an anti-abortion advocacy group, said in a statement that the American people want a fresh debate and a new direction achieved by consensus and built on love for both mothers and babies. The time is coming for the Supreme Court to let that debate go forward. Now, you may be familiar that Georgia recently signed an abortion law into effect as well. Not quite as strict as what Alabama just did today, but Missouri is likely to join the anti-abortion law states after members of the state conservative caucus broke a lengthy filibuster on an unrelated bill Tuesday to open the way for passage of a highly restrictive abortion bill. Bill Onder, state senator from Missouri, said, we will protect unborn children capable of feeling pain. And this is that was his comment on the legislative maneuver to take up the issue. He said, we will protect children who are the victims of brutal dismemberment abortions. We will protect babies with heartbeats. The measure would ban abortions after 8 weeks and require that both parents be notified in order for a minor to get an abortion, with exceptions. In addition, it would include a ban on abortions based on race, sex, or a prenatal diagnosis, test, or screening indicating Down syndrome or the potential of Down syndrome in an unborn child. Now, Alabama's law, not bill anymore, makes it a felony, a Class A felony, punishable by 10 to 99 years in prison for anybody attempting to perform an abortion or performing an abortion. Of course, the legislature passed it yesterday. It went to the governor, who was expected to sign it, and did so today. Now, in April, Ohio became the third state this year to pass a heartbeat bill, banning abortion as early as 6 weeks into a pregnancy. The ban takes effect after the detection of a fetal heartbeat at a point before the argument is some women even know that they are pregnant. As I mentioned, Georgia's governor, Brian Kemp, signed his state's law bill into law. Kentucky and Mississippi have passed similar laws. Meanwhile, heartbeat bills have passed one chamber of the legislature in Missouri, Ohio, and Tennessee, and have been introduced in Florida, Illinois, Louisiana, Maryland, Minnesota, New York, South Carolina, and West Virginia. Let me go ahead on record right now saying Illinois, Maryland, Minnesota, New York can hang it up. There's no chance. No chance those bills make it through. I hate it, but that's just the simple fact of what the politics are in those states. The bills hit at the nexus of the abortion debate, though, and framed the act in stark emotional terms, with proponents arguing that preserving life outweighs arguments against governmental influence and personal medical decisions. The Guttmacher Institute, which is a nonprofit group on sexual and reproductive health issues, finds the abortion debate ranges from seven states deemed very hostile to abortion rights, Alabama, Arizona, Arkansas, Indiana, Louisiana, Missouri, South Dakota, to one state, California, considered very supportive. The Institute says legislation is under consideration in more than 25 states to ban abortion in a variety of ways. These include trigger bans, which would automatically make abortion illegal if Roe is overturned; method bans, which would bar providers from performing a specific type of abortion, which is what Alabama did. They just basically outlawed every type of abortion unless, you know, there's a miscarriage, and then it's not really an abortion, even though you'll hear people argue that the medical terminology of a miscarriage is an abortion. Okay, terminology is one thing, science is another. Abortion is the willful killing of an unborn baby. Okay, they can term it any way they want to in a miscarriage. A miscarriage is not an abortion. Okay, so backing up, method bans would provide or would bar providers from performing certain types of abortion. And then reason bans that would prohibit abortion based on fetal characteristics such as sex, race, or disability status. And then gestational age bans prohibiting an abortion at a specific point in pregnancy, such as 6, 18, or 20 weeks after the last menstrual period. In April, North Dakota's Republican governor signed a bill outlawing a second trimester abortion procedure known as dilation and evacuation. The law, which includes the non-medical term human dismemberment abortion, and that is a non-medical term, granted, that doesn't mean it's incorrect, but it makes it a crime for doctors to use instruments such as clamps, scissors, forceps, to remove the fetus from the womb during the second trimester. Women getting the procedure would not be charged, but doctors performing it would face a felony punishable by up to 5 years in prison and a $10,000 fine. An exception exists for medical emergencies. Kentucky's bill has been stymied by a federal court order blocking enforcement and the first in the nation bill passed by North Dakota in 2013 was ruled unconstitutional, as was one passed last year in Iowa. To many anti-abortion voices, legal challenges are the point. And again, this goes back to what I was saying about the Alabama law. It was crafted specifically per the sponsors of the bill to make it to the Supreme Court and offer a challenge to Roe v. Wade. Now, the heartbeat bill is the next incremental step in the strategy, according to Ohio Right to Life President Mike Gonadakis. And he that was per an Associated Press interview last month. He said their whole purpose is to get Roe v. Wade overturned as well. So you have a lot of states that are looking to make a splash. And I'm thinking that it just you're going to see a bunch of them come together, I think, is what I think is going to happen. You're going to find a group of states that sue. That's just, you know, my thoughts. Each state's law is different and may have to, you know, stand on its own to challenge in the court. But I think that the states will come together and challenge Roe v. Wade as a group eventually. So, while other states embrace radical legislation to legalize abortion on demand through the ninth month of pregnancy up to the moment of birth, and even in some cases setting a baby aside after birth and then discussing whether the mother wants it to live or not and then possibly resuscitating said baby, disgusting. But this is what states are considering. So, when you hear people talking about how extreme this law is, and yes, it is a law right now, think about that. Think about being able, think about a physician, or let's back up, not even a physician. Let's say an abortion provider, which I don't think all states require them be MDs. I don't think. I will have to research that, though. Being able to sever the spinal cord of a fully developed baby that is crowning in the birth process. It's disgusting. It's absolutely disgusting. And likewise, the pro-abortion forces see the courts as an avenue to create precedents to fortify their position. After Governor DeWine signed the bill in Ohio, the ACLU response was swift and pointed, and they said, "We'll see you in court." Jennifer Dalvin, director of the ACLU Reproductive Freedom Project, that's we want to kill babies whenever we want to for those scoring at home, said recently that the attempts to go after Roe have been ongoing for a decade, but now the opponents are out in the open as to their goal. You mean kind of like the people that just want to kill babies, out in the open as to what their goal is. Meanwhile, she says states are also passing other laws, such as narrowly restricting clinic options for women that are quietly pushing abortion out of reach for thousands of women. Excuse me. Good for those states. Make it harder for those clinics to operate. Dalvin also notes that the Supreme Court already has a number of abortion-related cases it could take up immediately if it wanted to, and does not have to wait for a heartbeat abortion challenge to work its way up the appeals track. Laws against abortion are by no means a slam dunk, even in red states, okay? Make no mistake, proposed heartbeat bans failed to pass this year in Texas and fell short in Florida, South Carolina, Tennessee, and West Virginia. In addition, 13 states have introduced legislation that would establish legal protections for abortion or repeal what they view as outdated abortion laws. In January, New York adopted the monstrosity that they dubbed Reproductive Health Act that affirms the right to abortion until the fetus is viable and when the patient's life or health is at risk. It joins 9 other states in establishing legal protections for abortion. Similar bills have passed the first legislative chamber in New Mexico, Rhode Island, and Vermont, according to the Guttmacher Institute. Folks, what we're having right now is a battle for the future. I don't understand. Look, I'm not even going to pretend to know, okay? I've seen women lobbying arguments about what happens in the case of rape. Okay? And I know there are plenty of success stories out there. Children that were conceived in rape, whose mother went on to have them, raise them, and they have become good people in this world. And I get that. I feel for that, and I love that. But what I'm not 110% certain that every woman out there is capable of doing that and keeping their mental health. And I don't even like the idea of how that sounds coming out of my mouth, but I have to remove me and my feelings from it for a minute, because every one of these women that are going through the pros, the cons, the decisions, the choices that have to be made when it comes to abortion, every single one of them deserve our compassion. Because we will never, ever win this fight if all we do is shout them down, make them feel like garbage, and tell them how terrible they are. It has got to be one of the most difficult times in a woman's life. It's not easy, and not everyone can handle what's coming down the pipe, okay? But one way or the other, this thing is going to end. I know where my stance is. I always want to side on the side of the child. I always want to come down in defense of the defenseless. But I do understand the concerns, and I do have compassion for those making those hard choices. And we all should. And yes, good comment in the chat room. I am watching chat, guys. I know I haven't said a lot about you guys in there tonight, but yes, we could call this a holy war of sorts. It really is. I'm still not overly enthused with chat. You guys are going to have to beat the drums and get more people in chat. That's what I'm saying. I don't go first because I'm just the opening act. They do like the abuse in chat, don't they, Rick? I see them in there. I see them.
I'm just saying. I mean, I'm nice to them all the time, and my chat's almost always empty. But I also do shows a lot later than you guys, so I'm giving them the benefit of the doubt because of that.
I know. Mine fills up more as we get closer and closer, especially into that second half hour. I know how it is. I know how you guys are. You really love the bunny is what it is. I know it ain't the butter churner because I saw him in chat. I saw him in there. Saw you, Ordy. Appreciate you stopping by. Yeah, exactly. Where are the women? How much for them? I want to buy the women. and yes, Andrew, they usually are. Again, that your question is very valid. I don't know how that goes from state to state, but I do know that in most cases, that is the normal operating procedure. Bruh, I can't show any more skin. Really, I mean, come on. Y'all are sick. I love y'all. Oh, man. Okay. Yeah, get engaged with chat, you get more chat. Yeah, no kidding, huh? It's true. I see you poking back in there, Ordy. Hey, wait a minute. Is that that's Jeff. Is Jeff sober still? Number 11. We can move you up past 10. You can be in the top 10, Jeff. You can definitely be top 10. All right. So, look, we're getting pretty close to the bottom of the hour. I think what we're going to do, Rick, is we're going to burn the break a couple minutes early here. Because I just don't want to – well, you know what? I do have a short one we can do first.
Hey, where are the white women at?
That's right. I got a short one here somewhere. Where'd it go?
That's what she said.
Nah, I knew it was coming. I had to throw it out there, though. Come on. Where's my little short story? I packed one in here just for this.
It's short and you're packing it in. People are going to start getting the wrong idea about you, bro.
There we go. Okay, I got it. Okay. So, this is just filler material getting us to the break. So, Senator Cory Booker, presidential candidate for 2020, is going to reintroduce a bill aimed at preventing Immigration and Customs Enforcement from forming partnerships with local law enforcement. Now, as I mentioned, Booker is running for the Democratic nomination for president. He seeks to amend a section of the Immigration and Nationality Act with his own, quote unquote, Protect Immigration Act, even if that immigration is illegal, according to Corey. Basically, it would stop ICE from continuing their controversial, in quotes, controversial program, which effectively deputizes local law enforcement into federal immigration agents, which is garbage. It does nothing of the sort. Booker said, with limited time and resources, local and state law enforcement should be focused on keeping their communities safe and pursuing serious threats, not acting as ICE agents. So basically, what Cory Booker has a problem with is the fact that local law enforcement will honor an ICE retainer on illegal immigrants. That's what Booker's problem is. He doesn't want not tonight, Andrew, not tonight. But Booker doesn't want local law enforcement holding illegal immigrants for ICE. That's what he's getting down to here. And that's what he's trying to force law enforcement to actually ignore the law. And that's what his Protect Immigration Act boils down to. So anyway, we have hit the bottom of the hour. We're going to take that break and we're going to come back and we're going to continue some other. So do yourself a favor and stay right here.
Through some hoops.
Wanna get my body loose, wanna tell you what to do. I've been running out of breath like an animal struggling, looking for a diamond. I'm trying, I'm fighting, riding in the rhythm now.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans, America's largest mortgage lender. Spring will be here soon, so if buying a new home is on your to-do list, right now is the time to call Quicken Loans. Learn about which mortgage options make sense for you and get a jump on your competition. With our exclusive Rate Shield approval, the low rate you lock today is protected for up to 90 days while you shop for your new home. With a Rate Shield approval, if rates go up, your low rate stays locked. But if rates go down, you get that new, even lower rate. Either way, you win. Talk to us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com to take advantage. Here's another great reason to work with us. For a record 9 years in a row, J.D. Power has ranked Quicken Loans highest in the nation in customer satisfaction for primary mortgage origination. Again, to lock in today's low mortgage interest rate and get the security of our exclusive Rate Shield approval, call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com.
For J.D. Power award information, visit jdpower.com. Rate Shield approval only valid on certain 30-year fixed rate loans. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. License in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.
Hi, welcome to the Subway ad for the new Sesame Ginger Glazed Chicken Signature Wrap. How would you like it?
I'll take a...
Sports announcer at home?
Yeah, how'd you...
We just know.
My wife picks up the new Signature Wrap. It's got double the rotisserie-style chicken mixed with a sesame ginger glaze. She appears annoyed at me, but she shrugs it off. Those sweet and savory flavors are calling her name. She lifts the wrap and... She takes the bite! Incredible! And now she's closing the door on my... Subway, make it what you want.
Limited time only at participating restaurants. Double meat basement, average 6-inch sub.
All right, welcome back. So, let's see, what do we got to do here? I got to remind you that coming up at the top of the hour, FUBAR with PolitiBunny and Ordy Packard. I'm sure he's churning his butter right now and getting the fart noise machine ready for you guys. As far as Foo goes, we know what she's doing, right? Bonbon, baby. Hitting the bonbons. After them, Rick and Dan, and you never know what the hell those guys are going to do. They're crazy as shit. And then Rick Knight caps it off by himself with America Off the Rails. Do yourself a favor and stay tuned. It's the best and fastest 4 hours of grassroots conservative talk radio you're going to find anywhere. And TV sucks. So anyway... let's see, what else is going on? Oh, yeah, while everybody's heads are still exploding over abortion laws and this and that and the other thing, the New York Times is reporting that Attorney General Bill Barr has assigned John Durham, the United States Attorney in Connecticut and a Trump appointee, to look into the origins of the FBI's Trump-Russia investigation. And according to the report, Durham has a history of serving as a special prosecutor investigating potential wrongdoing among national security officials. Durham's investigation of the investigators is the third ongoing look at what spurred the FBI to get a FISA warrant on Carter Page, a Trump campaign volunteer who was never accused of a crime. The Justice Department Inspector General is nearing the conclusion of his investigation into the FBI's use of FISA applications and confidential sources in the in connection with the Trump-Russia probe. Now, former Attorney General Jeff Sessions, in November of 17, asked John Huber, the U.S. Attorney in Utah, to examine whether any matters not currently under investigation warrants the opening of an investigation. Now, Democrats, you know, they should probably be a little worried. They probably should. Not only them, not only Democrats, but people that claim they aren't Democrats, but really are, like James Comey. And this is per a former George W. Bush Justice Department official. He said if he were the Democrats, he would be quite worried. And this is the former Deputy Assistant Attorney General John Yoo. The reason why is by appointing a U.S. attorney, Attorney General Barr is essentially signaling that he thinks it's possible that criminal violations occurred in the start of the whole investigation into any kind of Trump-Russia collusion. As Barr said, there is already an Inspector General investigation going to come to a conclusion. That's what you would do if you were just interested in reforming the way the department does things, the way decisions are made. But you wouldn't go with a U.S. attorney like Durham, someone of his stature, unless the attorney general thinks actually something criminal might have happened, that someone might have violated the law, that there might have been malfeasance, that people at the FBI or the Justice Department were acting out of partisan motives, not just out of incompetence or stupidity, or that they were duped by Russians or Steele or the English or by the Clinton campaign. You know, all of these things are going to get looked at. So you says if you're a Democrat, I think you would be particularly worried to see the appointment of a career prosecutor like this. And of course, Barr, last month, told the Senate Appropriations Committee when asked, yes, I think spying did occur on the Trump campaign. Now, you've heard members of Congress and even the FBI try to play the use of the word spying down. They don't like that word because they know it's illegal, and they probably in the FBI know it happened. And there's already been a couple of stories where I've saw where they sent an undercover FBI agent, you know, okay, we can just let the investigation pan out. We don't need all these leaked stories. I don't even mean to go there. Just stop. But the question is whether it was adequately predicated, the spying, the quote unquote investigating that's not spying. Barr said it needs to be explored. Congress is usually very concerned about intelligence agencies and law enforcement agencies staying in their proper lane, and he wants to make sure that that's what happens, and that is what happened. And there are a lot of rules about that, and Barr says it's his obligation. He said, I haven't set up a team yet. But I do have in mind having some colleagues help me pull all this information together and let me know whether there's some areas that should be looked at. And I also want to make clear this is not launching an investigation of the FBI. Barr said he thinks there was probably a failure among a group of leaders there at the FBI's upper echelon. Hello, Mr. Comey. And if you think that this is all just BS, take into account that in the last couple of weeks, we haven't seen any Bible verses from Comey on Twitter. We haven't seen any of his smug introspective photos standing in the forest looking up at the tops of sequoias. None of that bullcrap has been going on the last few weeks, but you know what has been going on over the last few weeks? Comey wrote an op-ed trying to get out in front of this and explain it away. He's also done a super friendly cable news town hall where CNN was kind enough to lob all kinds of softballs his way and not produce any shred of journalistic integrity in helping Comey try to skirt this and explain it away. It seems like everybody's bending over backwards to help poor James Comey. I wonder why that is. So, and related to that, we have Congressman Ro Khanna of California. That's Ro is the first name and Khanna is the last name. He is a Democrat, of course. He says, if they want to do a review, they can do a review. But it's a total distraction, he said, following reports that Attorney General Barr has asked the U.S. attorney in Connecticut to look into the origins of the FBI's Trump-Russia investigation. You know, Khanna did his best to explain things away, claiming that a former general counsel for the FBI made it clear that the Trump-Russia investigation had nothing to do with the Steele dossier. Khanna said it frankly had nothing to do with the Trump campaign. It was on actionable intelligence from foreign ambassadors concerned that our democracy was under threat from foreign interference. Right. So the very people that they're accusing of interfering in the election, they're now saying they were acting on their tips that other people were trying to interfere. Think about that for a minute. And if you can actually follow Khanna's reasoning, he says it turned out to be correct. Bob Mueller concluded that there was sweeping and systematic interference from the Russians. Yes, there was. Shocking that foreign governments try to influence our elections, much in the way that we try to influence their elections. And if you don't know that we influence other countries' elections, then you have no freaking clue what the CIA is. So Khanna maintains that this is just a distraction and that an adequate investigation has already been conducted. Well, if that's the case, then what's the big distraction with Congress still going after Trump after Mueller's investigation showed there was no collusion? You see, the hypocrisy here is what just stands out. So the Inspector General of the Justice Department is almost done with his review of FBI procedures and actions, and are typically very, very capable, said Khanna. I don't think there's any need for an additional review. Well, of course he doesn't. Aren't they special when they start thinking on their own? They're just so adorable. He thinks that Barr is being political and trying to draw a false moral equivalence. He says there's clear evidence of misconduct by the president. Is there? You know, and that Barr is saying, no, there was misconduct by the FBI. The American people aren't going to buy it. So if you're buying it, you're apparently not American. If you're listening to Bill Barr, what Ro Khanna is saying is that you are not American. You simply can't be because you support Donald Trump, and that makes you un-American. I'm telling you, these people are completely friggin' unhinged. So, Khanna said, when you look at the pattern of conduct, his usurping the Mueller report, referring to Barr, and giving a selective summary shows his alliance. And now he's asking for a review about the investigators. I mean, it's like you're asking for a review of the people who caught the bad guys. So again, Khanna is saying that Trump is a bad guy here, even though there's no evidence to show that. And again, people are smart in this country, and if they don't see this for what it is, then they're not smart and they're not American. So basically, you either believe the Democrats or you're un-American. That's what this moron is saying. So, all right. So what else is going on? And hey, I see Sam in the chat room. Hey, Sam, how you doing? Everybody's saying hey to Sam. I see Jeff still in there. Jeff, four might be a little high, Jeff. I think you need to back it to about six right now. anyway, here we go. Okay, so next up, Kamala Harris. That's right, Jesse Kelly's girlfriend, Kamala Harris, told CNN's State of the Union with Jake Tapper on Sunday that on her 100th day in office, when she's elected president, don't you love the confidence? She's polling at 1%, and she's convinced that she's the one. Anyway, she said when she is president, on her 100th day in office, if Congress has failed to send her a bill with good gun control ideas, she will issue an executive order saying anyone who sells more than 5 guns a year must perform background checks on those they sell them to. Harris also plans to direct ATF to take away the licenses of gun dealers who don't follow the law. You think we don't take away the licenses of gun dealers that don't follow the laws now? Of course we do. Tapper asked if she would support a federal gun license as proposed by Senator Cory Booker, which would require fingerprints, an interview, and a gun safety course. Tapper noted that opponents of Booker's proposal said it creates a way for the government to track gun owners. She said, and this is her answer now, "I like the idea. But Jake, I'm going to tell you, on this issue of the need for gun safety laws, we're not at any loss for good ideas. People have been having good ideas for decades on this issue. We're at a loss for people in Congress to have the courage to do something." So what Kamala here is proposing is to just make it as difficult as stinking legally possible to own a weapon. She says, "We're not waiting for the worst tragedy because we've seen the worst of tragedies, including what just happened and the heroism of a child who we now mourn his loss, his parents' only child," adding that we're not waiting for good ideas. She can barely speak coherently because that's a quote from her. Okay. When I sound like I'm stupid, it's because I'm quoting politics on the left. Mostly. I mean, I do sound stupid sometimes, but they usually cause it. She said, again, "What we're waiting for is for Congress to have the courage to act. So let me tell you what I'm proposing. I'm proposing that on my 100th day in office, if elected president of the United States, if they fail to put that bill on my desk, I'm prepared to take executive action because that's what's needed, action." When asked executive action to do what, she said to do specifically for anyone that sells more than 5 guns a year to perform the background checks, comprehensive background policies. And then when asked whether that can be done via executive order, Harris says, yes, it can. "I'm also prepared to say and to direct the ATF to take away the licenses of gun dealers who fail to follow the law." Now, here's where Kamala stepped in it bad, okay? Here's where she stepped in it bad. She said 90% of the guns that are associated with crime have been sold by 5% of the gun dealers in the country. This could not be a more blatant lie. It could not be more blatant. So, we're 10 till. We got a few minutes. No, that wasn't AOC. That was Kamala. I was quoting Kamala Harris. Kamala Harris. Yeah, Kamala, whatever you want to call her. Jesse Kelly's girlfriend. He likes that Amy Clubfoot girl, too. But anyway, look, there's also a federal judge that said on said yesterday that financial records from President Trump's longtime accounting firm would be part of a proper subject of investigation by Congress, appearing to side with Democratic lawmakers seeking more oversight on the president. You can bet this will be appealed quickly. U.S. District Judge Amit Mehta in Washington heard oral arguments on whether Mazars LLP must comply with a House of Representatives Oversight Committee subpoena, marking the first time a federal court has waded into the tussle about how far Congress can go into probing President Trump and his business affairs. In an aggressive response to congressional oversight, Trump is refusing to cooperate with a series of investigations into issues ranging from his tax returns and policy decisions to his Washington hotel and his children's security clearances. Now, his lawyer, William Consovoy, asserted on Tuesday that the Democrats' subpoena fell outside of Congress's legislative function and that the House was claiming unbridled power to investigate Trump. Now, I'm telling you, when this gets appealed higher, that is what will come to pass, because there is limitation to the power of subpoena by Congress. And it has to be A, for a valid legislative purpose, or B, it has to be due to an ongoing funding resolution. Now, Trump's business dealings have absolutely nothing to do with the House of Representatives forming a budget, which is the second half, and it has absolutely nothing to do with any legislative matters in front of them. That's just, it's all filler, folks. They're just digging everything they can dig. We knew this as soon as they took power in the House. The entire 2 years was going to be obstruct, obstruct, obstruct. Stop Trump from doing anything he wants to do so that we actually have a shot at getting the White House in 2020. So far, this has backfired. Because nobody's buying into it. Nobody's buying into it. Meanwhile, we have record unemployment across the board. Every demographic is showing record unemployment. Wages are up. Tax cuts are in place. Joe Biden's threatening to take away tax cuts if elected because he says they're garbage and that none of us actually benefit from them. I like being able to take home more of my money. That's the way I look at it. So anyway, back to this court case. They've made it clear that this is not about legislation. They want to know if there has been any wrongdoing, Consovoy said, and that is not the purpose of Congress. And he's right. That is what the DOJ is for. But the judge disputed that, saying Congress could legitimately investigate whether Trump is complying with the Constitution's Emoluments Clause, which bars Trump-owned businesses from receiving payments from foreign governments. That would be a proper subject of investigation, the judge said. But that's not what they're after. So Mehta questioned whether under Consovoy's argument, many historic investigations by Congress would have been improper, including the probe into the Watergate scandal, which is completely different. And there is no legitimate proof or purpose for this investigation. Again, like I said, once this gets appealed, it'll be all over with. Don't worry about it. So anyway, hey, look, we're there. That's the show. Taxes are theft. Record low unemployment. Yes. The Dems know it's not the Iron Throne, right? No, they don't know. They don't know it's not the Iron Throne. School them while you're in there, Rick. Hey, look, if you like the show, tell your friends. If your friends like the show, drag their ass into chat next week so we can have a better time, okay? But seriously, if they like it, you need new friends. But they and you are welcome with me every week right here on KLRN Radio for the Conservative Curmudgeon Radio Show. I am your host, The Grouch. Peace. For a diamond, I'm trying, I'm fighting, riding in the rhythm now. I just wanna stay out all night, wanna stay out all night. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Just wanna stay up all night with you. Stay up all night. Just wanna stay up all night with you. I hate this place. Nothing works here. The medications don't work. I've been here for 7 years. Feel the grass, 'cause the last few nights.